In this episode of the Smart Community Podcast, I have a really great conversation with Alex Gerard. Alex is the CTO of Lift & Go. Alex tells us about his background and what he's passionate about, and also what a smart city means to him. We also talk about what's happening in France and Australia and the differences between the two. Alex then shares about what Lift & Go does, including carpooling and on-demand bus solutions. We then talk about how open data is a means of integrating across the different disciplines. We finish on talking about how, while the spotlight is on EVs and AVs, so electric and autonomous vehicles, we need to start talking about how they fit into the shared mobility space. As always, I hope you enjoy listening to this episode as much as I enjoyed making it.
Welcome to the Smart Community, smart regions, smart towns, and smart cities. It's where we live, work, and play with smart communities. The future starts today. Big data, smart mobility, emerging trends galore. The Smart Community Podcast is what you're looking for.
Hello, Alex. How are you today?
Hi, Zoe. I'm very well, thanks.
That's awesome to hear. Let's jump straight into this. And can you tell us about your background and what you're passionate about?
All right. So my name is Alexandre Gerard. I'm the co-founder and CTO at Lift & Go. And I came in Australia maybe 6 years ago now. And I was a consultant there. And since I felt in love with the country, the people, I just wanted to stay and apply my software engineering skills here on this side of the world. And yeah, that's it.
Awesome. So what sparked your interest in the smart city space?
Yeah, so I had created actually an app, a ride-sharing app called Backseat in 2014. And unfortunately, back then, the regulation wasn't in favor for this kind of shared economy businesses. So, I mean, that's at least one of the big reasons why we didn't manage to raise any funding. And therefore, I have unfinished business with the transportation area. And in 2016, Kevin Orr, the CEO at Lift & Go, approached me. And we found a way to apply some of this knowledge I had accumulated. And actually apply it to something that is way more meaningful. So it was carpooling or corporate ride sharing, more specifically. And that was really for me a way to solution or to at least try one more time to help with the struggle that I had experienced personally, and I could see everyone around me experiencing the same kind of issue, the commute to work, and yeah, making life easier, I suppose.
Cool. So what is a smart city to you?
A smart city is a concept that is, in essence, a way to, or actually a series of ways to tackle underused technologies and probably the new behaviors that are born from them and reuse them in a way that is way more efficient. I mean, the obvious enabler that Lift & Go is leveraging is the smartphones and the hyper-connectivity that came with it.
So why do you think that this concept is so important?
The concept of smart cities for me, it's going to provide a new, a new vertical for cities to solution some of their problems such as congestion, such as parking issues, such as pollution, and there is probably a few more using existing or at least the current infrastructure and maybe improving a little bit on them.
Cool. So how do you think Australia is currently embracing this concept? I hear I'm hoping your accent, if I am correct, is from Europe. I'd be keen to hear how you can kind of compare what you were doing back in Europe to Australia. What are your thoughts?
All right. So I'm actually from France, just in case it's not obvious. So compared to Europe and more specifically to France, I think Australia has something that is unique because when we look at the cities such as Sydney, and I think Melbourne is pretty much the same, it's low density compared to a city like Paris, where the buildings are actually quite high. Well, Sydney is actually spreading with a low density. So it's not an easy comparison, but I think that Australia is actually doing a great work to improve on their transportation, especially the public system. They are working hard on that, and that's exactly what a country like France is doing as well, because we share, I would say, some the same belief that transportation is a pillar for the society and to give everyone sort of the same chance. So in my opinion, Australia is actually doing a great work. It's not I would say it's not finished, and I wonder if it will ever be finished. But basically, they are looking at innovative ways to solve their problems, so congestion, and also their kind of unique challenges in terms of when we look at the geography with the bays, the bridge. So there is some arteries. Artery? Does that make sense?
Yeah, like arterial road?
Yes, some main roads, basically, that gets used a lot. But then you have some very blank or low-density areas that are left undeserved, unserved. And to plug them to the main roads, you have to find ways. And I can see that, I mean, looking at the stats, Australian people prefer to drive their own car, which is actually convenient and great for, I would say, selfish reasons. But it's actually causing some drama nowadays. So things need to change. And I think smartphones with internet is providing a very good platform to plug some good solutions such as carpooling, such as on-demand buses, and also some parking solution, and reduce the number of cars on the roads.
Cool. Well, thanks for sharing that. I've had a lot of conversations with people about like where Australia is sitting, and I think you hit the nail on the head there in saying that, you know, we have a lot of unique challenges, but we are really trying to improve that public transport system, whatever that means, if it means buses or trains or whatever, or sharing vehicles. I think Australia is doing quite a lot in that space. I mean, obviously, like you said, I don't know if it'll ever be completely done, because we'll just keep improving on things. So but I know that Europe has done a lot in that space as well, and France particularly. But I think you're right in saying that you know, our mindsets are a bit different with particularly when you're living in rural areas, is not necessarily an option to take public transport. So you need to have other options there, and you know, the most efficient, effective options for people, and you know, to suit their needs as well, and their wants and desires. So I don't think it's a hard and fast solution, like you said. So yeah, cool. So let's talk about some of the projects and things you're currently working on. I'm really keen to hear about Lift and Go.
Yes, so we now have two solutions. One is the carpooling solution, also known as corporate ride sharing, which allows a company such as, or actually a company or an organization such as universities, hospitals, and large businesses to set up their own private network where every employees, staff, or students will exclusively carpool with one another, thereby guaranteeing some security. And we incentivize this behavior by giving some reward, and also allocating bays in car parks. So that's one of our products where we work a lot on. We actually white label this solution for business parks, such as Connect Mac Park and Malfa. And there is also a lot of universities that are using our product for that, because it's, I think the impact on the environment is very positive, and they are very sensitive to this point. The other solution we've developed early this year, and that is live now in Huawei, is a on-demand buses application that is using some smart algorithm to enable shared buses that will actually do door-to-door commutes. So if you live in Huawei, you can launch the Cost Connector app and schedule a booking that will actually, the bus will come and pick you up at your front door and make sure you won't miss your train or vice versa. You out of the train, you go back home even late without any trouble. That's our second solution, which we actually believe will have a very good international success, because there is only a few solutions out there that are doing same kind of quiet, complex, on-demand bus solution.
Cool. Well, can you tell us how Lyft and Go actually started?
Sure. In 2015, Kevin and his partner were effectively struggling to commute, and they thought that there must be an app for that, an app to carpool, something convenient using the latest technologies, but nothing was there. Like, the best thing you could find was maybe a website where no one would be active. So Kevin decided to fix this problem, and he went through the Jumpstart program from the NRMA in New South Wales, and he succeeded. He went through the program, raised a bit of funding, found some business partners, Tristan and myself, and we started to work on the product. We had for our initial client the University of Newcastle, and we launched, I think, in August 2016. So just 6 months after starting working on the app.
Yeah, awesome.
And after that, yeah, that's it.
Yeah, cool. So can you tell us how the carpooling app or solution works?
Sure. Any organization, whether you are a university or a business, you can actually contact us, and we can set up quickly a network that will be private to their employees, their staff, whoever they want. Once we actually enable them to connect to our solution, they can start specifying their trips, and we will match them based on their departure, arrival, and time, which is quite convenient, because they can quickly create a ride exactly like you would do in any ride-sharing solution, and therefore doesn't have too much friction for the users.
So you kind of deal directly with the company that someone works for, the building or whatever, and then employees of that building can use your service then to carpool with other colleagues. So is that right?
That's right. That's right. So we actually target the business owners or executives, and they will launch the product and make it available for free for any of their employees.
Cool. And do you have to offer like any incentives or whatever to kind of get people to use it?
Yes, it's a way at least to increase engagement. So what we do is we select the top 10 of each companies and distribute some prize, such as fuel vouchers or any kind of prize that will work. This way, not only we increase engagement, but also we make sure that people actually have a good time.
Cool. And can you tell us a little bit more about the on-demand bus service as well, where it is and what you're kind of doing in that space?
Sure, yes. So the on-demand bus is actually targeting the agencies or any transportation provider. And the way it works is we launch a product for them, specifically for them, to then monitor and run their operation. The beauty of that is it's pretty quick to set up, and it's allowing a very high patronage. And also a lot of data capture. So the likes of Transport for New South Wales really, really appreciate the initiative, because at the moment, whenever they try to, I would say, gather data around the current public system, it's a bit of a, they basically have a low data point, whereas we have a very high one, a lot of data points.
Yeah. How important do you think data is, you know, when we move towards this kind of smart mobility?
It's crucial. Data is driving decisions. And with the data we accumulate, we can actually make a concrete decision, not just gut feeling kind of decision. And therefore, you can back up any kind of initiative with data analysis. So for me, and actually I think for Liftengo, it's a core value we provide them with.
Yeah, cool. So kind of leads on to this next question, because obviously with data, we're going to have to integrate across the different disciplines, and you know, data helps make those decisions, you know, easier or to be made on, you know, evidence base. How do you think that we can better integrate across, you know, the different disciplines, government and industry?
It's a tough one. I think obviously we need to create bridges between those disciplines and government agencies. So the first one, I would say the obvious one, is open data. And by that, I mean giving people and agencies the access to some of your data. If you're an agency or actually a business working in the smart city environment. Why having this kind of open data? It's because I believe that it's really hard to anticipate what the others will need. Therefore, you're better off just opening your as much as you can to the rest of the world and let them pick whatever they believe is useful for them. That's one thing. And another thing is obviously more events to motivate people to think about this kind of problems, or I should say challenges.
Conferences and initiatives and to get people together. Is that what you mean?
Exactly. You can have local meetups. Then, if you scale that up, maybe conferences and so on. Yeah.
Just to get people talking.
Yes.
Awesome. No, that's a great idea. So let's talk about emerging trends. What do you think people aren't talking about enough?
Oh, well, that's a tough one, I believe, because I think people are talking a lot nowadays.
Yeah.
In this space, the smart cities and specifically mobility one, there is all of the spotlights are on the electric cars, the automated vehicles, yes, and maybe some of that is going towards shared mobility. So in our case, I believe that the autonomous vehicle is the one that will compound very nicely with our solution, because I think that the likes of, you know, any transportation network companies like Uber, GoCab, they actually they make it more affordable to travel around, but it's also creating congestion. So unless we start having some shared mobility companies and reduce the number of cars, I think it won't solve any issue.
That makes sense. I think talking about, like you said, people talk about the EVs and the AVs, but we need to also talk about how they fit into that shared solution, so then we don't just create more congestion at the end of the day.
That's right. I don't really know anything else that people aren't talking enough about. I think the public's transportation system is a rip for an update.
Yes.
And that's where we intend to play a part. And we are not talking enough about it, I'm sure. So, yeah.
Yeah, no, I agree. And I think, there's lots of room for disruption in that space, and I think it's coming at us and will hit us before we kind of know it, and it's already happening, like you said. And I think that with the shared space, thinking of different models that aren't, you know, that might work in different areas and that kind of thing, I don't think it'll be a one size fits all approach.
I agree. No, there's no such thing as one solution that will fit every problem.
Yeah, definitely. Awesome. Well, it's been so great to chat with you. I really just have one last question, which is, how can people connect with you?
There is probably a few ways, such as email or LinkedIn. I'm also on Twitter, so my email will be alex@liftango.com, liftango. And I'm happy to share any more details online on my LinkedIn. You can look up with my name. I'm sure you can find me.
Awesome. I'll put the links in the show notes and people can click away and find you. Thanks again so much for talking with me. I look forward to chatting with you again soon. I'm really interested in the different solutions for mobility and how we're moving forward in that space, because I think it's a real key pillar, like you said.
It's been a delight to talk with you, Zoe. Thanks for having me.
No worries.
And yes, don't hesitate to reach out again.
Yeah, awesome. Thanks, Alex. Talk soon.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Thanks so much for listening to the Smart Community Podcast. Show notes for this episode and all other episodes are available on our website, mysmart.community. If you have any questions for us or any of our guests, you can email hello@mysmart.community or find us on the socials. We are on LinkedIn, Facebook, and Twitter @smartcompod. That's com with two M's. If you are enjoying the podcast, please leave us a rating and review at wherever you listen. This really helps us reach more ears, so thank you in advance. As always, I hope you enjoyed listening to this episode as much as I enjoyed making it.
The Smart Community Podcast is what you're looking for.